that you have saved me, Lord. Give all that I am to you, that every day I would be a light and shine your name. Every day, Lord, I'll serve and stand upon your word, and I pray that I might come to know you more, that you will guide me in every single step I take, that every day
yourself into that position when people invite you, or people do this, or you get to meet people. The same way it works with God. When you put yourself in the position of saying, God, here I am ready to encounter you, I am ready to take in whatever you want to speak into my life. Same way works today. Just speak to him. Just say, Lord, I want to know you. I want to know you more. I want to be that person. I want to be open to you, to everything that you're saying into my life.
Thank you.
our hearts before you, God. We fully surrender to you, God. We submit ourselves under your authority, Heavenly Father. We yield ourselves to you, Lord. We understand that we need you, Jesus, in our lives. We understand that we need your word, that we need your presence, God. And we humble ourselves under your mighty hand tonight, because your hand is mighty to save. Your hand is not too short to save today. Your hand is not too short to heal today. Your hand is not too short. But God, your hand is in this place tonight, and you are doing your work in our hearts. And we as a church, as young people, we say, God, that we yield to you. We say, Jesus, you go first. You go before us. We desire to be with you. We honor your presence. During this time of worship, I just believe the Holy Spirit put this on my heart. The Bible says that no one knows the day or hour when the Son of Man will return. Nobody knows. We don't know when Christ will return. And as we were just singing those songs, we're like, we don't even know if maybe Christ will return before this worship time is even over. We don't know. Nobody knows the time when Christ will return. And we were singing those songs that we will wait for you like a bride waiting for her groom. Do you know how a bride waits for her groom on the wedding day? With such expectation, with such excitement, thinking this is the best day of my life. I'm about to be married to my groom. With such expectation, waiting for him. The bride perfects herself every way possible. She prepares for months for her wedding day. Are you preparing for Christ and for when he's gonna return? And the Bible also says that every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Every knee will bow. Can you imagine that? I was just thinking that to myself. All of humanity that ever lived on the face of the earth will bow down before Jesus Christ. That will be Stalin. That will be Hitler. That will be Obama. That will be every celebrity. Every athlete, no matter how great or how small. Every knee shall bow before the name of Jesus. And every tongue will confess. Many people will not confess Jesus until it's too late. He will say, I never knew you, to many people. And that's just the word. I believe the Holy Spirit has that for some people here tonight. Is that you don't know when Jesus is coming. Have you already confessed Jesus as your Lord in your life? Are you letting time linger and linger, thinking I can do it later. I can do it later. I can do it later. Make Jesus the Lord of your life. He's the one that draws your heart. There's a reason why you're here today. It's because he drew you. And it was not your decision. Jesus is drawing your heart. Surrender to him. Because either way, one day you will bow. And one day you will confess that he is God. But unfortunately, it will be too late for many people. While God's favor is here, and while there is time, make that decision in your life. And you'll have an opportunity to do so later on in the service. Jesus, we thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the word that you have given today. We thank you for your presence and for the wonderful worship team. Jesus, we love you so much. Let your name be glorified and magnified in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people said, amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, worship team. You guys can be seated. I'm looking for a couple people. And they are here. Okay, we want to do something right now. It's gonna be bittersweet, but we want to have a time that we could just pray for a couple people that are here today, because they've been with us for a while, and for, you know, for different reasons, they're going to be leaving our church and leaving to go live somewhere else. So actually, I wanted to invite Sveta and I wanted to invite Christina both, and we just want to pray for you too. So let's welcome them up here. So from the face of the youth, I just want to tell you guys that we love you guys very much. It was good to be together, and we're always brothers and sisters in Christ, even though the Lord has other things for you guys as far as where to live. Christina's going back to the country of Georgia, and Sveta, I believe you're going to Portland, Oregon, right? So not too far away, just down the coast. Christina, a lot further. So but what we want to do is just, we want to make sure that you guys just don't just leave and nothing that we didn't even notice. We want to give you the most precious thing that we can, is that's our love and that's just our prayers and blessings for you, that wherever you go, that God uses you there, that you are fruitful there, and that just your life is a light to the world wherever you may be. So youth, let's just go ahead and do that. Let's just pray for these two beautiful young ladies, our sisters, and if a couple leaders can come up and we'll just pray for them. Viola, Lino, and who else is here, guys? We just welcome you. Just want to pray for you guys and just bless you guys in Jesus' name. Go ahead, brother. Lord, we thank you for our sisters, Lord. And we thank you, God, for this time that we had together to be with them, God. And we thank you that you have placed them in our lives for this short period of time, God. And we thank you, Jesus, that they have been a blessing to us, God, that they have been here with us. They've been serving. They've been using their gifts of singing and teaching, Lord. And we just thank you, Father, that they have been amongst us, God, and in our midst. Heavenly Father, we pray in Jesus' mighty name tonight, God, that you bless them and keep them safe, Lord God, as they're going to be going to a new place and where they're going to be living, God. We just pray, Lord God, for your blessing upon their lives, God. We pray, Lord, that their lives are fruitful, God, that your favor rests upon their lives, God. We bless every aspect of their life, God. We bless them physically, spiritually, mentally, emotionally, financially, God. Every aspect of their life, God, we pray that you cover them, Lord God, with your grace. That you cover them with your love, Lord. When they go to a new place of living, Father, I pray, Lord, that they find themselves in service, that they find themselves in ministry, God, that they, God, produce fruit in the kingdom no matter where they go, Jesus. Let them be that light. Let them be that example to young girls, to the young ladies around, Father. I pray, Lord, that you use them in a mighty way, Jesus. Let them be the light of the world no matter where they may be. And we bless them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you, sisters. And like I said, it's bittersweet. But praise God for this time that we had together. I just want to share a little bit on more. Just we're going to go smoothly into announcements right now. And I just want to talk about the first announcement. That's just the fact that we do have summer camp coming up, and they'll maybe show the video later today. But in regards to summer camp, this is currently the situation. Yes, this is the date we have here, August 5th through 8th. Our theme is ID, basically speaking about our identity. And the price currently is $170, and we plan to keep it at $170. It's not going to be going up any higher. This is our guest speaker, Roma Trachuk. He's a pastor in G4T. He's a pastor of their English service that they've recently opened. And he just has powerful testimony. God's just moving amazingly in his life. He's actually also an evangelist and just does awesome stuff. And we're just trying to bring out the best speakers that we can in order for our camp to be just super awesome, super blessed. But this is the situation before we get to summer camp. Summer camp is us as a leadership team and us as a youth working together to have an awesome time together. It's for spiritual growth. We have 5 services planned, and it's just focused on youth in order for us to grow together spiritually and also, of course, to have a lot of fun and fellowship together. I checked the list of how many people signed up last week, and unfortunately, it's still very, very low. And a lot of people are saying, well, maybe, maybe not. I'm going to go. I don't know. And unfortunately, if there's a lot of maybes, we as a team, we're considering to just cancel summer camp if needed. because, you know, we're not going to go because it's just, it's a lot of finances that we're putting in. We're flying in speakers. It's just a lot of effort, a lot of energy put into summer camp. But if as a youth together, we want to do things together, if there's not enough people going, then, you know, why is there going to be a few of us there and just putting a lot of effort into a nice camp, but it may not be worth it if our youth is not there. We're doing this for you guys. The effort is all for us to be together, for the fellowship to be together. So the trial period is this. It's basically we have 2 weeks. If within 2 weeks we have enough youth signed up, then we're going to go forward with summer camp. If within 2 weeks we do not have the number that we're looking for, then we're going to plan something else. We can do just a different thing with the youth. We can have some kind of maybe cool services or fellowships, whatever, something else, but not summer camp, because there's just going to be a lot of finances put in, like I said, flying in speakers, and if it's not going to be worth it in the end for the youth to benefit, then it's not really benefiting us as a whole. So if you're the people that are saying maybe 50-50, I don't know, you have 2 weeks to decide and to sign up. Otherwise, it's going to be a no summer camp. So I'm going to pass on the mic for the rest of the announcements. Who's Alex? But tonight, yes, after the service, you do have an opportunity to sign up and with this man here for summer camp.
Yes, that's right. Tonight, if you actually want to sign up, speak to me. I will be in that lobby standing and signing up. We accept cash, and card as well. So speaking about the other announcements, let me open up. Okay. Friday night prayer. As you all know, we have Friday night prayers. It's on Friday and at night, 9 p.m., still the same time. So it's actually a wonderful time when you come, when you, after the long week, you can come and say thank you to God and also pray for your needs and ask someone to pray with you. And sometimes that's what basically is needed. Sometimes it's hard for you to do the breakthrough, and then you come and say, brother, just pray for me, or a sister. I need a prayer together. And the Bible says the righteous prayer can do a lot of things. So I encourage you to attend those Friday night prayers, and if you have a need, seek God when he's near. That's what the Bible says. The third announcement is Mexico Orphanage Fundraiser. This is something new. We want to do this together with the Lagom Sea Coffee and Tea. This will be a special night when all the baked goods will be donated, all the proceeds from the baked goods will be donated to orphanage. That means we will have special baked goods, some goodies, some sweets, that it will be next week after youth service. So you can come to the coffee shop, and everything that you will be purchasing in regards to the food will be going towards the orphanage, the building of the orphanage. So you can also donate, you can support. As you maybe don't know, we're actually supporting the orphanage in Mexico, in Mexicali. We're actually building houses there, building. So first we build the laundry room, then we actually built the computer class. And now we're actually in a process of building living houses for them. Basically, it will be a big building where they could be all sleeping. So we're actually it's under construction. That's why we're doing this fundraiser to raise some money, also to use this money for the program with the kids. Okay, so let's do next announcement. Tonight, unfortunately, coffee shop will be closed. But next Thursday will be open. Simple. So come next Thursday and coffee shop and support orphanage in Mexicali. And last announcement, it's in regards to media volunteers. We do need people who can do cameras, who can do audio, who can do design, who can do a bunch of other stuff. So if you feel that you have a talent and you feel that you can actually do this, or you think you can do this, just come talk to me. I will, you know, find you something to do. And also, we need someone who has designer skills. who would like to work with a Photoshop, Illustrator, After Effects, something like this. So if you know or even heard those terms but have a desire to learn, go talk to me. I'm the man. Okay, I think that's all for the announcements.
What's up, guys? I'm going to be doing an offering. And yesterday, I was looking for a verse to do about offering, and I stumbled across this story, which kind of like made me think a lot different. It's the story when God was speaking through Malachi to the people, and this is what God said. "Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation." Wow. I read that, I was like kind of mind blown, guilty, you know, like, and God is pretty much saying, you know, when you come to church, you give tithes and offerings because God blessed you, he gave to you, so you are giving his portion back to him. We all know that everything that we own, our money, cars, everything, it's not us, it's all God given. Everything we have, it's all God given. So when we come to church to give, we give back a portion what's his. And actually, when we don't give tithes and offerings, we're actually pocketing back God's possessions into our own pockets, and we're not giving God what's rightfully his. And God said basically to these people, like, you guys have robbed me, you know? And I was reading the rest of the verse, and it was what God said. He said, "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will be no room enough to receive it." God is here saying, test me, test me. Go bring your tithes and offerings to church and see how I will not open the floodgates of heaven and pour out my blessing on you. We can already see that in our own lives. When we give to God, God never leaves us needy. He never leaves us to want for anything else. He always supplies us, and he always blesses us no matter what. And it's amazing how God works. He blesses us with all these finances. He blesses us with so much things he blesses us. And then all he asks is for a portion in return. And when we give that portion to him back, he blesses us even more. And it's just like this wonderful cycle. And all God is wanting is just a portion for you. Just have that faithful heart that will do, that will give for the Lord's work. Amen. If I can have you stand up, we're going to pray. Lord God Jesus, we thank you for this time and service, Lord Father God, that you let us gather here in your name, Lord Father God, to support for this time of offering, Lord Father God, as we give. Lord Father God, we want to give our finances with a joyful heart, Lord Father God, because we know that nothing that we have is ours. We all know that, Lord Father God, to support that you've given us, Lord Father God, you blessed us with everything, with our finances, Lord Father God, to support. Help us to have that heart, Lord Father God, that gives it back to you, Lord Father God, that blesses you, Lord Father God, back, Lord Father God, that we give it to the glory of your kingdom, Lord Father God, and support. I pray and ask for the rest of the service, Lord Jesus Christ. Bless this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise God, youth. I know a lot of us aren't here today. The teen ministry camp started, and a lot of people are there, but I'm happy to see so many of you are here and ready to see God move. Amen. I know that he has a powerful word ready for today, and I'm excited. How many of you guys are excited? I think that one thing that we should always be is excited to come to church. A lot of people, I'm like, it's almost like a burden. It's like, oh man, I got to go to church. I'm like, you don't want to be there on Thursday? Like, you don't want to be at church on Sunday? What's wrong with you? You know, Jesus needs to get your mind right. So, okay, the other week, my family, we went to the Grand Canyon, and awesome place, great view. I always heard about it, I always saw pictures, but until I went there, I was like, wow. You know, it was one of my dad's dreams. He's like, I want to go to the Grand Canyon, and he bugged me and my brother for so long that we eventually planned this trip. We went out there, and one of the things I noticed that the Grand Canyon is a beautiful place. It's an awesome place. We were walking along the rim. We were looking out, and it's miles and miles of just canyons that God himself chiseled with his mighty hand. And it's so beautiful. And we come back, And I'm at work one day, and we're sitting at lunch, and my dad's talking to his employees, and he's like, guys, you know, we were standing there. We were right at the edge. You look down, and it's a mile deep. You look across, and it's nothing but canyons for 10 miles. And his employees are like, mm-hmm, all right. And they don't understand it. And I realized that until you go there yourself, you are never going to know exactly what it feels like to be looking out at the Grand Canyon. Anybody can explain it to you, just like anybody can stand up here and explain to you the Word of God. But until the Holy Spirit shows it to you himself, you are going to just sit there and wonder, what is this guy talking about? Amen? And that's what I want to happen today. You know, we're going to be talking today about Joshua. He's just a blessed man of honor that we're going to be talking about. And I want you guys to just allow the Holy Spirit to show you. One day, you know, I don't know how often you guys pick up your Bibles, or some of us in my day, you know, the Bible collected some dust on it and we get a little guilt-tripped about that. But just pick it up and read the story for yourself. What I realized as I was preparing is no matter how many times I read through the book of Joshua, God continued to show me revelation after revelation, whether it's one word that I missed. And that's what the Holy Spirit wants to do in your life. I believe that that's a mighty word that God wants to speak into your heart today. So Joshua, how many of you guys know Joshua? You know, I think that we hear a lot about Moses, and then it's kind of like Joshua kind of dims out there. But I was amazed at how much God did through Joshua as well. And just to be the successor to Moses, one of the greatest men that we read in the Bible, and Joshua had to fill his shoes right after him. Can you imagine, Pastor Alex just comes to you and he's like, you know, hey, Brother David, or hey, you know, sister this, you guys need to take this highest position in the church right now. And you're like, am I ready for this? You know, but one thing that God told Joshua from the beginning is, he's like, I am going to be with you. I am going to be with you. Take courage. Take boldness. Just know that I'm always with you, and I'm never going to leave you. And I will be with you as I was with Moses. And there's so much power in that. So Moses was the son of a man named Nun. Son of Nun. And he was part of, his father was part of the tribe named Ephraim. And this tribe was one of the descendants of Joseph, which I found amazing because we just talked about Joseph last week. So we go down generation after generation. Here we have Joshua, another blessed man of God. And one thing that I just want to start off with about Joshua is that Joshua lived about 40 years of his life in slavery. He was one of those men that was in Egypt, that was under slavery, that was under oppression, and he experienced, as Moses took the Israelites out and led them across the Red Sea, and at this age, he was freed from bondage. And that's when God began to raise this man up. He was called to be a great military leader, one of the greatest that we can read about in the Bible. And it's just amazing at how much God did through this man. You know, yeah, he was 40 years old when he left Egypt, but God still used him. God took him out of slavery at that age and raised up a mighty leader. And when Joshua took over for Moses and began to lead the people into the promised land, it's just God used him in such a mighty way. Well, his story begins, and I just want to show you guys one of the things I realized about Joshua is it's amazing how much he did after he took over from Moses, but I really want to focus on for a brief moment what he did while he was preparing, while God was preparing him, because how long were the Israelites in the desert for? For 40 years, they were in the desert, and throughout this time, from the moment that Joshua was taken out of Egypt to the moment that Moses passed away, and it was now Joshua's job to take over, God was preparing him throughout this time. And one thing we see is we first hear about Joshua in the battle against the Amalekites. The Amalekites come and attack the Israelites while they're in the desert. And Moses says, you know, he's like, Joshua, take over. Lead the people into this battle. And he says, okay, you know, I'll do it. And it's just amazing at how what God begins to reveal to him in this time of his life. You know, this is within probably a year, maybe two, how they got out of across the Red Sea and into the desert. And one thing that God begins to do is we see, and you guys have probably heard about this battle many times, where Moses is standing there with his hands up, and while the Israelites are fighting against the Amalekites, the Israelites are winning, right? And then what begins to happen? Moses' hands grow weary. They start to fall down and they begin to lose. And in this, I believe that God was beginning to speak into Joshua's heart. He was teaching him a very important lesson and showing him that, Joshua, you know, you might be the military leader here. You might be the one leading these people, but I alone am the one who is fighting for you and bringing the victory. Amen? And Joshua just began to learn this. And through his time growing and growing, he was very close to Moses. And one other instance that I see in his life that I just kind of giggled at how he responded. There was a time when the Israelites were really burdening Moses. They're like, man, we want food. We want real meat. We're sick of this manna. You know, we've been eating this for ages. And at Egypt, we had fish. We had crops. We had all this great food. And here, you know, we have to eat the same stuff every day in the desert. And Moses comes and cries out to God. He said, God, Lord, he said, this is too much of a burden on me. I can't handle this. And God tells Moses, he said, collect the elders, and I'm going to take some of the power of the Holy Spirit, the authority, and put it upon them. And what begins to happen is these elders begin to prophesy. They begin to prophesy around the tent of meeting. Two of them, it says, are in the camp. And look what Joshua says. I just laughed when I read this. He says, let me see where I'm at real quick. He says, Joshua, son of Nun, who had been Moses' aide since youth, spoke up and said, Moses, my Lord, stop them. But Moses replied, hold on. He says, stop them. Joshua, it's like they're prophesying. This is a great thing. The elders are prophesying. You know, Moses is sitting there amazed at how God is just raising up these leaders in the camp, among the Israelites. And Joshua's like, Moses, you know, do something about this. They're taking your glory, man. They're taking this away from you. You're the only one who's supposed to be doing this. And look what Moses tells him. He says, are you jealous for my sake? I wish that all the Lord's people were prophets and that the Lord would put his spirit on them. Moses rebukes him real good right here. Amen? He's like, man, you got the wrong picture set up in your mind. This is a young Joshua, maybe not so young in our eyes, considering he was probably in his 40s, going towards 50s by now, but he's so jealous for God. He has such a desire to see God move, and he's like, man, I want that for myself. You know, Moses, don't you want all of that for yourself? You know, don't you want all of God's glory to move through you only? But Moses is like, no, man. Listen to me, life is not about you taking the reins and leading everybody and doing everything for God yourself. Life is about building up leaders among you. And that's what Moses was amazed by. Joshua learned a very important lesson that in all things, he has to honor God in allowing other people to grow also as leaders. And one of the amazing things about Joshua is he was always by Moses' side. It says he was Moses' aide, basically his assistant. Almost like you have an assistant that walks around and does all your paperwork, knows everything that you're doing. He knows all the transactions. The assistant knows when you want your coffee, when you want all this stuff. He knows when you have a meeting. And Joshua knew all this stuff about Moses. He knew when Moses was going up the mountain. He knew every time Moses walked into the tent to meet God. And he was always right there by the door waiting. He was waiting by the side of the mountain as God is speaking to Moses. He was waiting and just watching and amazed at the relationship that Moses had with God. How many of you guys are just, you know, one thing that I realized is that it's very important to grow amongst the leaders around you, to watch what they do, to learn from them, because there are many lessons in life that you don't have to go through yourself. Like, for example, if I'm going to go and stumble over something, over a rock somewhere, as I'm walking, and you're right behind me, if you saw me stumble over that, are you going to go and do the exact same thing? That would be foolishness. And that's what Joshua, throughout this time, he saw Moses. I believe even in that moment when Moses, instead of speaking to the rock and telling water to come, as we talked about last time for a brief moment, when Moses hit it, instead of giving honor to God and listening, God tells him, you know, speak to the rock. But instead, Moses hits it. And Joshua learns these little valuable lessons along the road of what it really means to serve God, how jealous God is for us, how much God loves us, and also the little things that he needed to honor God in. Moses was not allowed into the promised land because of this one small moment where he did not honor God. And I believe that Joshua learned from this lesson. And that's one thing that I want to lead you to. Point number one is honor God in all things. That was a powerful lesson in Joshua's life. Throughout everything that Moses did, he learned. And this is one thing that I believe all of us have to just have engraved in our hearts, is that God desires to be honored in all things. Not just when we come to church to say, God, we glorify you and we lift you up and we're here for you and we honor you today. And then you walk out the doors and for the rest of your time outside of church, you don't honor him at all. When somebody asks you how you're, this morning, I was at work and somebody's like, hey, how's your day going? I'm like, you know, my life is good. And just the moment that I realized that I didn't say, praise God that my life is good, I was like, whoa. You know, I could have said something. I could have given God the glory here. I could have told him that this is God blessing my life. And it's like those little situations where God really begins to see how faithful we are. How much do we really honor God in all things in our life? One other time of Joshua's life and his preparation that I want to point out is when he was a spy. You guys have probably heard of the story of the 12 spies, when Moses sends out the 12 spies to go look at the promised land. One thing I want to note here is that God had already promised this land to the Israelites. He had already said, I'm giving it to you. You have the victory here. Just go and take it, and I'm going to give you this entire land. And when the 12 spies are sent out by Moses, they go out and they view the land, they look at what kind of people are there, how the crops are doing, what everything looks like, and they come back, and 10 of these guys begin to complain before the entire congregation. They're like, guys, you know, these people are huge, they're giants, this land is not good, we're not gonna be able to overtake it, they're gonna destroy us. What is gonna happen? It's not worth it to even go here. They begin to complain, why are we in the desert? Why didn't we just stay in Egypt? But one thing I wanna note is what Joshua says, and this just shows how much over the time that he has been growing with God, how much his view has changed. This is what Joshua says. Son of Nun and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had explored the land, tore their clothes and said to the entire Israelite assembly, the land through which we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. What is the difference between, this is like night and day. 10 people, the majority, now come back and say that these people are huge. Nothing is going to happen. We're not going to take over. But Joshua says, I am going to honor God with this moment that he gave me, and I am going to give him the glory and say that he promised this land. He promised this land. We are going to take over this land. And he encourages them. And the fact that they tear their clothes, this was a sign of grief in that time. Not only did he want to give God the glory, but he was grieving before everybody, the congregation. He said, why can't you guys see what I see today? That God's promises are going to prevail over anything. Don't through your human eyes, sometimes we look at things, we say, this battle is too big for me. This is going to overcome me. But when you look at the Word of God, Jesus says, nothing is going to overcome you because I am with you. So which side do we pick in those situations? Are we part of the majority that are going to say that I'm not going to overcome? Or are we part of the minority that are going to trust in Jesus, that are going to just say that the victory is already won, it's been promised, and I am going to go and take it? Point number two. Honor God, and God will honor you. One other word I can use here is God will exalt you. God will lift you up. God will raise you up if you honor him. When we look at Joshua throughout this time that he has been growing, people see that he's become kind of a respected leader. They see him always around Moses. They see that he's learning. They see that he's growing. He becomes respected among them. And this is just a moment that I want to point out in Numbers 27:18. That God tells Moses, he says, lay your hands on him right now. This is when Joshua is first commissioned, when he is first told, you are going to take over the leadership in Israel. You are going to lead them And this is the moment where Moses lays his hands. And it says, so the Lord said to Moses, take Joshua, son of Nun, a man in whom is the spirit of leadership, and lay your hands on him. This is just a very powerful moment that I want to point out, where God is preparing Joshua. Joshua, in his walk with him, he is beginning to prepare him for leadership. And Joshua, I can just imagine what is going on through his mind. Moses, can you think about this? If you were kneeling right here and Moses comes and begins to pray for you and says, God is going to use you to lead all of the U.S. This was not a small nation. I don't want you guys to think Israel was like 5,000 people, that like Moses had a chance to get to know everybody. No, this was like 2 million people that Moses was leading. And he's like, Joshua, God is going to bless you. God is going to raise you up. God is going to use you. And God begins to exalt Joshua. You know, one thing I used to see, the way I used to honor God or think that I was honoring him, is I would have this wonderful calculation that I created out of my human knowledge. I would say that, okay, the amount of days that I attend church, plus the amount of hours that I read the Bible, plus the amount of hours that I pray, equals how much I honor God. And this would be my calculation, and I would always think that, okay, if I've been honoring God this week, he is going to use me. If I've been honoring God this week, I'm going to go to school, and somebody's going to approach me, and I'm going to be able to speak to them, because my calculation shows that I've been honoring God this week, and thus I am worthy to just speak to this person, or I'm worthy to be used by God. And that was such a wrong mindset, to be thinking that I would ever be worthy aside from what Jesus did for me. Joshua, as Moses is laying hands, I think that this was a lesson that Joshua learned over his years. And even in that battle with the Amalekites, that I may be a good speaker, that I may be a good teacher, that I may be a good person, that I may be a good singer, and I'm going to go up there and I'm going to do this by myself. But one thing God engraved in Joshua's heart, that Joshua, it is not you. It is always going to be God who is going to exalt you. No matter how hard we try, no matter how well I prepare my sermon and come up here and speak it to you, if God is not walking with me, nothing is going to happen in this place. It might sound like a good word. Apostle Paul said that it might sound like a good word, but that's not God moving through it. And that's one thing that Joshua learned. That's one thing that I think that God really wants to engrave within our hearts, is to realize that it's never been us, it's never going to be you, and there's never going to be a day where we are going to be worthy of anything aside from coming to the cross and saying, Jesus, you did it for me. That is where the victory is. That is where our worthiness is. That is where your righteousness comes from, where you can be appointed to be used by God at the cross. That is the place alone where you receive that authority. As Joshua begins to take over and Moses passes away, Moses is not able to enter the promised land, and Joshua now takes over to lead all of Israel into the promised land. And this is one thing that God tells him. He says, no one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous. God speaks this into Joshua as he takes the position of leadership. And the people now are saying, Joshua, whatever you say, we are going to go and do it. Wherever you lead us, we are going to go. With one little exception, as long as God is with you, as he was with Moses. You know, it's like, how do you feel in that position? It's like, only if God is with you as he was with Moses, we are going to follow you. And in Joshua's position, it's like, those are hard shoes to fill. But only with God, Joshua realized this, that only with God am I going to be able to take this position of leadership and to lead these people where God wants them to be. And the first thing that he does now is he sends out two spies into the land. He says, okay, go out and look at Jericho primarily. And at this time, they're still on one side of a river, the Jordan River. And he sends out these two spies, go look at the land. Check it out. How does it look? Are we ready to go in? And these spies go straight to the city of Jericho. This was one of the most prominent cities at the time. It had huge walls around it. This was a city that was almost like a symbol of how powerful the enemy was. So he sends them out. These spies get into the city and they go to this, I believe she was a prostitute, and they go into her home. Rahab was her name. And they begin to ask her, what's going on? Like, how can we get into the city? All this stuff. And Rahab tells them, one thing that she tells them, she said, our city and our people are already, our courage has been destroyed. Our hearts have been melted. We are in fear of you, the Israelites. You know why? Because she said the way that God led you through the Red Sea, the way that you guys took over those kings in the desert, the enemy is already scared before Israel has even crossed the Jordan. This is a sign that victory is surely to come. The enemy is already trembling. And these two spies, they end up coming back and telling Joshua the good news. So Joshua now prepares to cross over the Jordan River. Of course, when you have 1 million or 2 million people, this can be a complication, amen? You know, it's like all of us trying to go across the Sacramento River right now and take your car with you and take all your belongings with you. And it's like, that's not going to happen. One thing about the Jordan is this was a time when the Jordan River was flooded. It was very wide, and it was muddy all around. Like, there's no way you're getting this many people across. And God tells him that today, Joshua, I will begin to exalt you before the people. And Joshua now prepares the people. He says, consecrate yourselves as we are about to cross. And he sends the Ark of the Covenant with the priests. And the moment those priests' feet touch that water, it says the river stops flowing. The river stops flowing. The river that is, it says, a mile wide across to get across this river, it stops flowing. And 2 million people begin to cross the Jordan. Some of them stay behind because that was their land that God left for them. And then they begin to cross and the water is standing still. The water is standing still. These people, they get across. The priest with the Ark of the Covenant, the moment that their feet touch dry ground, says the water's flooded again. And this is just a wonderful miracle that we see again. You know, I hear a lot about the Red Sea being split, but rarely do you hear about God stopping the Jordan from flowing. And I'm like, you know what? What's the difference between the two? These are both miracles of very high stature and power where God exalted Joshua through this and also brought glory to himself. And as they cross over, they cross over this river. And one thing I want to note is that the first thing that Joshua does is that he has the people consecrate themselves. He has them circumcise themselves. And he gives God the honor. They build, they've taken 12 rocks from the middle of the river and they build up a pillar. And they say, Joshua says, till the end of the age, people are going to know throughout the earth what God has done in this place. And they're going to bring glory to him. This is going to be for God's glory. In Joshua 4:14, it says, that day the Lord exalted Joshua in the sight of all of Israel, and they stood in awe of him all the days of his life, just as they stood in awe of Moses. The people are in awe of Joshua. All of these people have now seen the first powerful miracle that God has done through Joshua, and they are in awe of him. Look at where this began. This all started with the small situations where Joshua honored God. But now God has brought him up to become a leader. He has exalted him. He has begun to raise him up. And it says that the people are now in awe of Joshua. Not because he went around trying to get people to like him, trying to teach them good things, trying to just get people to look up to him. But because he honored God first, God exalted him. So often what we try to do is that we try to make ourselves look good. We try to go out and we try to make people think that we're a good person and to be liked. And we have a lot of Facebook followers. We have a lot of Instagram followers. And wow, we're respected. We're valued by people. But let me tell you one thing today. If you try your whole life to honor yourself, you're going to lose everything. Joshua could have lost everything. If you go your entire life, you will lose it all. But if you seek to honor God, He is going to exalt you and He is going to bless you like He did through Joshua. Point number three, honor God and victory will come knocking at your door. One of the things that we begin to see in Joshua's life is many victories in battle. As he begins to take over the promised land. The first of those is before Jericho. And as he approaches the city, God encounters him before the city walls. And God tells him, one, he tells him, take off your sandals. And he begins to speak to him. He says, march around the city six times. Six times, once per day. And on the seventh day, march around it seven times. And then see what I'm going to do through you. See my glory that's going to come. Joshua began to honor God in obedience in this situation, and he sends the people. Can you imagine like a million people marching around a city every single day? Can you imagine the fear that is going through all the members of the city in Jericho? They're like, why are they marching around? They're not doing for 6 days. They're just marching around. On the seventh day, they march around seven times. And it almost seems like, what is the point of this? What is going on? But Joshua knew that in obedience, if I honor God in obedience, the victory will come. On that seventh day, they march around seven times. And then all of the people, they scream. And the walls of Jericho come falling down. They take over the city. And the victory comes purely through God, purely through that obedience to God's will. After this, one thing I want to note is that Joshua right away goes into another battle. He decides that, okay, there's the city Ai. We're going to go take it. We're going to go take this city right now. And the men go out. And they begin to attack the city. And keep in mind that this is right after this powerful work of God in Jericho that he did. The walls were broken down. The city was taken over. And now he's like, all right, you know, I'm feeling good. God is using us. God said that we're going to take over the land. He says, go and let's take over this next city. He said, I'm ready to go. And the men come running back. As the people of Ai are just chasing after them. 36 people, it says, died. 36 men. Good man died. And why? Joshua right away tears his clothes and he comes before God. He's like, there's no way that you led us here just for us to die out here, to be defeated out here. God, what happened? What do I do? God tells him, the people have taken of the devoted things. One of the things that God warned them about was not to take anything that was devoted to God for themselves. And one man of Israel, Achan is his name. It turns out, and Joshua found this out later, after they had already been defeated, that this man, Achan, had taken some gold, some silver. He'd taken a robe for himself and he hid it somewhere. And this caused defeat in Israel. This small thing brought defeat to Israel. And why? Why? Because one member of Israel, one member of the 2 million, did not honor God in keeping in obedience with what he said. This one person brought defeat for the entire nation. Can you believe this? We're almost, I stood there in wonder of just how righteous God is. He wants us to keep that command. And in this, I'm amazed because of one guy. Because of one guy, you're like, why would you just, 36 men died because of this one guy. Because he did not honor God. I want to move on to another occurrence with Israel, and this is probably going to be one of the last examples that I give. I'm not going to get into the details, and you guys can read about this yourself, but there comes a city, these Gideonites, and they kind of befriend Israel. They kind of fool them into thinking that they're from a faraway land, and they become their neighbors, and they kind of they make a promise to them, basically, that we're going to have a pact. And what happens is these Gideonites were basically members of this land. The land, these Gideonites were probably supposed to be destroyed. And one thing that happens is now there are these five kings around that are saying, all right, these Gideonites, their men are mightier than Ai that was just destroyed. We need to stop this before Israel grows even stronger. These five kings say, all right, we're going to gang up together and we are going to destroy Israel before they destroy us, before they start taking over all the land. And it says that there were men numbered more than the sands in the sea that began to come against Israel. They began to go against the Gideonites. And it says that Joshua, right away, as soon as he hears about this, he takes all of the army. They march all night to get to the city. And you know what happens? God again moves in such a mighty way through Joshua. God, right away, it says that God brought a confusion among all of the enemy. They began to attack, and the Israelites right away, there's defeat in the enemy. Those that came and surrounded them, the enemies that joined together to attack them, there is already defeat because God began to work in that place. And I'm just amazed. God always reminded Joshua that it was him. He said, I am the one that brings the victory. Only me, Joshua, no matter how good of a military leader you are, it's always going to be me. And this kept him humble over the time. It says, as the enemies were running away, it says, hailstones fell and killed more men than they even defeated. This is a work of God that moves. And then it goes on. And Joshua, he's like, you know what? There are still some guys out there. There are still some guys out there. They're not getting away. He says, son, stand still. And I'm amazed at how God heeds to his voice and just exalts him in this moment. And it says the sun stood still in mid-sky for basically until nighttime. For like 24 hours, you could say that the sun did not go down. It says until the enemy was truly defeated, fully defeated, the sun did not go down. I want to tell you guys something. And I want you to really get something out of this example. That sometimes we go into a situation, into a battle in your life, whether it's from an addiction, whether it's something that's going on with your family, a relationship problem, whether it's something with school, financially you're having a problem, and you're in the midst of this battle. The enemy has joined against you because they saw a victory somewhere, and they say, no, before this guy grows stronger in God, before his ministry grows, we need to take him down, and Satan is going to send all that he has against you. But God will provide the provisions for you. Just like in this situation. In this situation, it wasn't just them fighting. God brought down the hailstones. God kept the sun in the sky. God brought confusion. In the midst of your battle, I want you to know that God will provide everything that you need. Sometimes we have our eyes set that, all right, I have my sword, and that's the only way that I can win this battle. That's the only way that I can overcome this addiction is if I stop hanging out with my friends. That's the only way. If I stop doing this, if I start reading the Bible, that's going to get me out of this. And our eyes are set on this. And it's not on everything else that God said. He said, your victory is in Jesus. It's never going to be in anything you did. God will provide the provisions. He's going to send somebody into your life that is going to pray over you. He's going to just send a miracle into your life that will bring victory no matter what. Why? Because he has promised it already. He promised it at the cross. He already defeated Satan at the cross. There is already victory. And God says, no matter what you come against, I am going to be with you as I was with Moses. By faith, receive that. The Holy Spirit is in you today. The Holy Spirit is moving within you today as he was in Moses. It's the same Spirit. It's God himself within you, and he's going to provide for every single victory what you need. Amen? Joshua at the end of his life, and there's like a whole chapter where you're just going, and they defeated the king of this, the king of that, that was one, the king of this one, the king of that one, the king of this one. And it's like this whole addition problem where they calculated every single king that they had destroyed. And I'm amazed that at the end of Joshua's life, guess how many kings were destroyed? How many of you think it was like under 10? More than 20? Okay. It was 31 kings that had been destroyed. Starting with Jericho, 31 kings, one after another. And this wasn't within like 50 years that they were fighting for a long time. Within two years, 31 kings destroyed because God always brought the victory. There may have been an error in Ai, but they learned their lesson. They learned their lesson. We will honor God, and we know that through this, victory will always come. There was never a defeat after that. There was never a doubt in their hearts that God will bring the victory, and he was faithful on his part. He is always going to be faithful on his part because he said it, and God's word is going to be till the end of day true and faithful and alive in your life. Just let it speak to you. Go to the Grand Canyon yourself. Allow the Holy Spirit to teach you this himself. You don't have to listen to this from me. You can, and it's a great thing to receive revelation from somebody else. But go and find out for yourself. See the wonderful view that God has in store for you. Your expectations in life are going to change. Your views on life are going to change. The way that you see yourself are going to change. And there's beauty in that. Amen? At the end of Joshua's life, and he died at about 110 years old. I hope I live that long. By the will of God. In Joshua 24:14, for those of you who want to turn there, I'm going to read a few verses. And this is something, you see this in Moses as well. At the end of his life, he gives a fair warning to the Israelites. And this is Joshua again. Joshua again speaks to the people. And he's like, all right, you know, all this knowledge that I accumulated in my life, everything that God has been teaching me, he's like, I just want to summarize it into one big point right now. I want to make it clear to you that it's never going to leave your heart, that it's never going to leave you. And just if you get one thing out of being with me all this time, hear my voice in just this. He says, now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves today whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. This sounds familiar, right? Does this verse sound familiar to you guys? How many of you guys have heard, me and my house will serve the Lord? How many of you knew it was from Joshua? a few less hands. You know, we see this on bumper stickers. We see this on people's walls. You go into somebody's house, it's like right there. It's a huge painting. And it's like, wow, we just went through the story of Joshua. And at the end of his life, he's like, if you get anything out of it right now, listen to this. He said, right now, choose for yourself. You have a choice today, just as the Israelites did that on that day. He says, you can either serve God, the God that just showed you his glory through every single one of these victories, the God that you saw just did everything in his power to bring victory into your life, or you can go and serve the gods of the people that were living here, of the land that we just took over. You can serve the gods that they served on the other side of the river. He said, you have a choice. And that's the beauty of God. That he doesn't condemn you and just pull you to him and say, you have to serve me. He gives you a choice. And today, you have a choice. You have a choice who you want to serve. But I want to tell you one thing, youth. Make this real in your heart. You are always serving somebody. You're always serving somebody. And that's the one thing that Satan wants to just blind you about. That no matter what through your life, you are always going to be serving somebody. Whether it's God or Satan or whether it's the idols in this world or any of these things, you are always serving somebody. And Joshua got this. He understood it. He's like, please, please, as long as you do this, as long as you serve only the God Almighty and don't run away to idols, as long as you don't fall away, God is going to provide for you. He's going to continue to defeat the people around you, your enemies. He's going to continue to work his glory in you. But please, just serve him. You have a choice. One thing that even Jesus said, he said, no man can serve two masters. You're either going to love one of them and you're going to hate the other one. That's the reality of life. A lot of people want to fool us out of that to say that, oh, you can live the double life. You can be a Christian and you can go out and party. You can go to church and you can drink. You can do all of this and your salvation is guaranteed. You're guaranteed a good life. Because you have the best of both worlds. You're like, I have salvation in Jesus, but yet every single day I can come to him and say that I'm forgiven today, and thus I have salvation. But as Serge said earlier today, you never know when he's going to come. You're playing almost like a gambling with your life. For those people, maybe it's one of you here today, or I know that a lot of people have their hearts set on this and they're like gambling with their life, that every day it's a 50-50 chance. All right, you know, I'm going to go out, I'm going to live the good life, I'm going to do what the world says is fun, and I'm going to, at the end of the day, I'm going to come to Jesus and I'm going to pray for forgiveness, and he's going to cleanse me, and then I can serve a little bit, and then I can go back to what I was doing, and then I can be used again, and I can go back and forth. But what if Jesus comes on your bad day? What happens then? What happens when you come before God and he's like, you messed up, man. I'm sorry, lady, but I never knew you. What happens then? What happens in that situation? There were times where I placed myself in that situation, and you don't have any words for it. You don't have any words to say. Even Jesus warned us. He said, everybody's going to come up to me and say that, look what we did for you. Jesus, on my good day, I served you. On my good day, I honored you. On my good day, I came to you and I received from you. And I had victory in these little battles here and there. But overall, what does your life have to show for it? Nothing. Because you lived to honor yourself instead of honoring God. And in the end, you lost the battle. The fight was not won. That is a reality in every single one of our hearts. That this, if you don't place all of your hope in Jesus, if you don't have your life set upon the cross every single day, that there is a chance that you will fall away. And that's one thing that I don't want to happen to anybody. That's one thing that Joshua did not want to happen to anybody. He said, you don't have to fall away. You don't have to experience defeat in your life. You don't need any of that. And that's the reality of Jesus and his love. Is that he said, I already want it for you. My blood right here, my blood, just let it wash you. The cross right here is where the victory is. The victory has been promised, yet we go around fighting every single battle as if we have to. We go around with our sword and we're like, all right, I'm gonna fight this guy, and I'm gonna fight this guy, and I'm gonna fight this addiction, I'm gonna fight this problem. And in the end, it's like, Jesus is like, come on, man, just let me win it for you. Let me give you the victory. Let the hailstones fall on your enemy. They're already scared of you. They fear you. And that's the truth, is that in Jesus, we have been given that authority that everybody in the spiritual realm, every single demonic spirit, every work of Satan, their hearts are just melted before you because you have authority in Jesus, amen? Because the Holy Spirit is within you, amen? Because God allowed you to live that life of power and glory. He will exalt you. And today I just want to put this before you. I want to put this before you as clear as day, that you have a choice today. Will you honor God? Or will you live your life having another idol? Will you live your life serving somebody else and risk the shot of getting into heaven for some pleasure that is just going to last for a small, minute time? I want you guys to get up. And close your eyes. One thing that many of these Israelites did not experience is they did not enter the promised land. There were many Israelites that were walking with Moses that did not experience the promised land. they were not allowed by God to walk across the Jordan and to experience what God had planned for them, what He promised so long ago, because they chose not to honor God. Today, make the decision for yourself. Do you want to honor God with your life? Do you want to serve Him? And do you want to experience victory in your life today? Do you want to see what He has to offer for you? Do you want to allow the Holy Spirit to take you to that place today and to move through you? That's a question that every single one of you has to answer for yourself. I can't make the decision for you. Not even God will make the decision for you. It's up to you. And today, I just want to call you guys forward. If your relationship with God has been failing, if you've been fighting battles that are not supposed to be fought by you at all, you're in the wrong place, you're in addiction, you're in some kind of problem, and you don't know how to get out, I want to say one thing, that Jesus has victory for you today. That God wants to fight that battle for you and bring victory into your life. Choose today. If you want to honor God with that and give Jesus the privilege of being Lord of your life. If you've never done that before, if you've never given Him the honor of being Lord of your life, if you've never come to Jesus and given Him the honor of making you righteous and making you holy and breaking you away from the world, I just call you forward right now and we can pray for you, and this can be a decision that is going to bring change into your life. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you, Father, that you have allowed us to just go through the life of Joshua today, God, and to learn, Father, to learn from his mistakes, to learn from his victories, God, to see how you moved in his life in such a mighty way. Hallelujah, Father. We want to see this today, Father. I want to see victory in every single heart in this place. I want to see you move, God, in such a mighty way. That we wouldn't be stuck fighting battles to our left and to our right, God, but we would see something more in life. Something that Joshua saw, God. Something that Moses saw in you, Jesus. Something more than this world has to offer to us, God. Open our hearts today, Father. Let us see your glory today, God. Father, we want to see your glory in this place. Hallelujah, Father, we want to renew our relationship with you today, Jesus. Hallelujah, Father, just bring restoration into our hearts, Jesus. We want to give you the honor today. We want to give you the honor, Jesus. We want to give you the honor today, Lord. Be Lord of our lives. Be Lord of our lives, Jesus, because we need you, Jesus. We want you, Jesus. We need you, God. And we are nothing without you, Lord. Don't let the world lead you to a place where you are going to choose yourself over God, where you'll choose an idol instead of God. Because the world is always going to pull you there. It's always going to show you that this is better. God has been around for ages. You need something new. You need this new thing in your life that is going to satisfy you. The new car, the new home. You need the schooling. You want to become a better person. Come here and let us show you something new. Let me tell you something, generation. Jesus has something new for you today. Every single day of your life, He will have something new to show you. Just come and allow the Holy Spirit to take you to that place where you can experience it for yourself.
You're my King.
fighting a battle that may not be spiritual, it can be. If you need healing, I want to call you forward today. I want to tell you one thing, church, that Jesus never intended for you to be in pain. There may be some times in your life where you're going through hardships and God is testing you, but He never intended for any Christian to have any disease, any of that in Jesus' name. He never intended for that in the church. You don't have to live with any cancer. You don't have to live with any sickness, any disease, any of that, because Jesus said, "In my wounds are your healing." Emotional healing. There are many people that struggle with this. Your emotions take you left and right, but you don't know how to control them. They draw you to the left and to the right, and it just takes you to a place where you are burdened, where you are failing, and you don't know what to do. I want to tell you that Jesus has healing for that today. Only Jesus has the cure. Father, take us deeper. I know you're not through. Jesus is not done moving in this place. I want to tell you one thing, church, that it may not be in the first 5 minutes, that it may not be in the first hour of your prayer, but victory will come, and God always has something in store. Don't come to Him saying, "In 30 minutes, I want you to move, God. I know that if I pray for an hour, you are going to do something." But honor God. I had an experience recently. Just yesterday, we got together to pray for the Mexico trip. We got together, we fasted all day, and at night, we got together to pray. And my eyes, you know what they were set upon? You know what they were set upon? It was set upon going to Chipotle before 10 o'clock, before those doors closed. And yeah, the prayer was powerful. Yeah, the prayer was good. But when 9:30 came around, I quit. I said, "I'm done. Chipotle's gonna close. I'm not gonna get there in time." And I hopped in my car and I drove out. I want to tell you something. Like a spear, the Holy Spirit came and convicted me on my drive home. I could not go to that place anymore. I said, "God, how could I do this? I'm speaking on this, honoring you in the small things, and yet look what I've done. I couldn't wait 10 more minutes to just pray in your presence and honor you, God, in these last minutes." That was a lesson that I never want to go through again. And that's one thing, guys. In the small things, don't put a time on God. Don't give Him a time frame to work in. Don't tell Him that, "I'm going to serve you for this long. In 5 years, I'm going to come to you and I know that you're going to move." God wants to do something today. He wants to do something today. Whether it's in the last minute of prayer, He wants to penetrate your heart today. Don't leave this place saying, "I didn't get anything today." Don't leave this place saying, "God had nothing for me." Because I'm going to tell you right now, He has something for every one of you. If it's healing, it's healing. If it's prophecy into your life, it's prophecy. If it's victory over a battle, that's what it is. If He wants to give you a revelation, will you honor God today and allow Him to speak into your life? Don't walk away from your blessing. Don't walk away from the victory. Don't walk away from the cross and refuse what He has freely given to you, church. Because that is all your decision. It's always going to be up to you. Every day you wake up, you have a decision. Will I honor God with my life? Or am I going to honor that game? Am I going to honor the club? Am I going to idolize pornography? Is this my choice today? God, I want this instead of you. It's always going to be your decision. God always puts the plate before you. And Jesus says, "Will you eat at my table today, son or daughter? Will you take what God has to offer for you today? Or are you going to push away the plate and refuse it and say maybe another day. We never know. We never know. I just want to give him another minute or two in this silence. Just allow him to work in your heart. Say, Holy Spirit, penetrate deeper. I want to surrender more. I want to break down those walls and just allow you to move right now. And sometimes in those quietest moments that God speaks such a mighty word into your life that you can never go back to anything else again. Brings you running back to Him. Let's give Him a minute to just work in us. Father, I want to thank you, God, for the privilege of being here today. Father, for the privilege of coming into your home and receiving from you, Father, what you have had prepared since the beginning of age to give us, God. What you have spoken into our hearts today, Holy Spirit, what you are going to continue doing as we walk out of these doors. Hallelujah, Father, just let this word continue, Father, to just penetrate deeper into our hearts. Let it fall on good soil, God, that in our life, wouldn't seek, God, everything else in this world, but to honor you, Jesus, to honor you every single day as we approach the cross, and we give you the honor, Jesus, of being Lord of our life. There's so much beauty in that. There's so much love within that. It's not a burden to come to the cross. It's not a burden to serve God. It's not a burden. He never intended it to be like that. The world is going to teach you that. The world is going to show you that you are going to miss out on so much more. That the world has so much more to offer. Give God a chance. Give God a chance to be Lord of your life. And see what He has in store for you, church. Don't go your entire life hearing about God. Hearing about how He took you out of slavery or how He took this other person out of slavery and what Jesus did for you, but experience it in your life. Allow God to truly touch your heart and see what it means to have victory everywhere that you go, to have blessing, whether it's in your finances, whether it's in your body, to have healing, whether it's just to have a good relationship. Just allow God show you what He has in store for your life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your work in our hearts. Just continue to touch us over these days and to just penetrate deeper, God. Just continue to give us revelation. every brother and sister in this place, Father, I pray that as they leave, God, may you just put in their hearts a desire to serve you, God, a desire to honor you, Father, and just give them a glimpse, Father, of how much you want to do in their life. We want to give you a chance today, Jesus. Every single day, we want to give you a chance to do something in our life. We honor you today, Father. We bring honor to your name, God. We want to glorify you. We praise you, Jesus. We lift up your holy name.
Man, I was blessed. Were you blessed today? Praise God for what he's doing tonight. So our service has come to a close. Coffee shop's not open tonight, as you guys know, but if you are interested in summer camp, you have the opportunity to sign up, and you can go ahead and do that. Otherwise, God bless you guys. Just hang out. Have a good time. Hit the music, guys.